Welcome to you once again. In this lecture, I will give you some experimental devices based on the Fresnel's half period zone, Fresnel class of diffraction, which is, as I have already told, that the diffraction pattern occurring due to the source screen as well as the aperture placed at the finite distances. The first example of this type of device is a zone plate. A zone plate is an optical device which works on the principle of Fresnel's zone, and the effect at a point due to the alternate zone cancels each other. And we have already seen that the resultant amplitude due to the entire half period zone is equal to M1 by 2, where M1 is the amplitude of the first half period zone. Now, a zone plate is an experimental device based in such a manner that the alternate half period zones are blackened so that no light passes through the alternate half period zones. In this half period zone, we construct the half period zone by, suppose we take a sheet of paper, and in the sheet of paper we draw concentric circles with a radii which is proportional to the square root of natural numbers. For example, the first half period zone is of, say, square root of 1 centimeter, the second half period zone will be square root of 2 centimeters, the third will be square root of 3 centimeters, and so on. Now we see that the area between the first and the second half period zone is blackened, and similarly between the second and the third half period zone is blackened, and so on. The alternate half period zones are blackened. A photograph is taken, and a photograph in the negative, we will see that the blackened portions will come as transparent. In the negative of the photograph, the alternate half period zones, the first half period zone will come as transparent, the second will be dark, and so on. So we can make two types of half period zones. If we take the negative only, we will get a positive zone plate. If we take the positive of the negative on a transparent sheet, we will get a negative zone plate. So in the positive zone plate, odd zones are transparent while even zones are opaque. While in the case of the negative zone plate, the even zones are transparent and odd zones are opaque. Now, in this diagram, we see, suppose A is the distance between the source S and P, and B is the distance between P and O. We see the first as the half period zone, PM1 as transparent, and M1, M2 as opaque, and so on. Now, for the first half period zone, A and B are such that this SM1 plus M1O, now this will be at equal to SP plus PO plus lambda by 2, such that the distance between SPO and SM1O, that changes by lambda by 2. Similarly, for the second one, SM2, this is equal to 2 lambda by 2, that is lambda, and so on. For SMNO minus SP plus PO, this is equal to SP plus PO plus N lambda by 2. So, in this manner, the distance increases by the order of the half period, half lambda by 2, that is half of the wavelength as we go to the successive higher order half period zones. Now we see some mathematics here. Smn is equal to square root of sp square plus pmn square. So this will be equal to a square plus rn square, and which we can approximate to a plus rn square by 2a. Similarly, mno is equal to square root of pa square plus pmn square. This is equal to b plus rn square divided by 2b. Now, substituting for smn and mno, now we get this is equal to smno will be equal to a plus rn square by 2a plus b plus rn square divided by 2b, and this is equal to a plus b plus lambda by n lambda by 2, because the distance in terms of lambda is equal to n lambda by 2. So we have rn square 1 upon a plus 1 upon b is equal to n lambda, or rn square is equal to n lambda ab divided by a plus b. Now, since ab and lambda are constants, so rn is proportional to square root of the natural number. So they behave like the half period zones, Fresnel's half period zones, as we have discussed earlier. Now, area of the half period zone, area of the nth half period zone will be equal to pi rn square minus rn minus 1 square, and we can see mathematically this is equal to pi lambda ab divided by a plus b. So we see that area of the nth zone is independent of the order n. So we can say that area of the half period zones are equal. All the half period zones are equal. Now, the amplitudes of the different half period zones will be equal to, as we have seen in the case of Fresnel's half period zones, this will be equal to a m1 minus m2 plus m3 and so on, which was equal to m1 by 2. But now we have blocked the alternate half period zones. So the amplitude corresponding to m2 will be equal to 0. Similarly, the amplitude corresponding to m4 is equal to 0. And that means all the amplitudes corresponding to all even half period zones will be equal to 0. And therefore, the resultant amplitude A will be equal to m1 plus m3 plus m5, and so on. It means that by replacing the zone plate in case of an ordinary aperture in which all the half period zones are transmit, in this case, as the light from alternate half period zones is blocked, we get the amplitude added up and we get a large amplitude corresponding to the sum of all the half period zones, and therefore the intensity amplitude, resultant amplitude as well as the resultant intensity will increase many times. And this is the first test of the Fresnel's theory of half period zones, that a zone plate in which the alternate half period zones are blocked, the resultant amplitude increases manifold. So we get a much higher intensity. Now, if we look closely into the formula, we have this is equal to 1 upon a plus 1 upon b. We have seen here this is equal to rn square is equal to n lambda ab upon a plus b. Now, for a particular zone plate, a, b are constants, and for monochromatic light, lambda is a constant, and therefore we can just write down 1 upon a plus 1 upon b is equal to n lambda, or 1 upon a plus 1 upon b is equal to n lambda upon rn square. So if we compare it with the formula, this in the case of a lens, we see the formula is 1 upon v plus 1 upon u is equal to 1 upon f. So the joint plate, in this case, if we put a source at the point S and see the image at the point O, then we see that it acts like the intensity, as we have already told, that the intensity increases many times. This acts as a converging lens. Because for the converging lens, the formula is 1 upon V plus 1 upon U is equal to 1 upon F. And therefore, we can say that a zone plate acts like a converging focus lens, which we, for which the focal length is given by Rn square is equal to n lambda. So we can, this gives the value of the primary or the first order focal length of the zone plate. So zone plate acts like a convex lens. Now, there are some similarities and dissimilarities between the convex lens. The first one is zone plate works on the phenomena of diffraction. And whereas in the case of the convex lens, we know that it works on the phenomena of refraction of light. The light is refracted from different points of the lens and converges at a point corresponding to the focus of the lens. Then odd zones, zone transparent plate produces real image of the this means the light which we get at the point on the screen is that converges from different parts of the wavefront and we get a real image. The convex lens also makes a real image. Now it shows a chromatic aberration, and chromatic aberration means it has different foci for different wavelengths of light. In a zone plate also, the focal length depends upon the on lambda, F is equal to n lambda upon Rn square, and therefore it also shows chromatic aberration. For a given wavelength of light lambda, a zone plate has a different focal length given by the expression this, which I will explain just now after this slide is over. A convex lens has a single focal length this for a given wavelength given by the formula 1 upon F is equal to mu minus 1 1 upon R1 minus 1 upon R2. Intensity of the images decreases with the order of focal length, because in this case we have multiple foci, which I will explain. In the case of a lens, we have only there is only one focal length. Intensity does not depend upon the focal length because there is only one focal length. In the zone plate, red focus is nearer the plate than the violet focus. V is equal to is less than FR. In this case, the case is opposite. Violet focus is nearer than the red focus. So these are the similarities and dissimilarities between a zone plate and a convex lens. Now let me explain why a zone plate has multiple foci. So as the formula foci is, focal length is F is equal to Rn square upon L lambda. Now, where R1 is the radius of the first aperture. Suppose we slide the screen towards the aperture, we will see that the size of the half period zone increases. It will decrease. Size of the half period zone will decrease. And suppose at a distance B, it occupies only one half period zone. At a distance of B by 2, it will occupy two half period zones. And similarly, at another point, it will occupy three half period zones. Now, when we change the distance to say B by 3, then the amplitude, it will occupy only two half period zone. The amplitude will be equal to of the this half period zone will be M1 minus M2, and therefore there will be no light at that point. But if it accommodates three half period zones, then in that case the resultant intensity again becomes M1 minus M2 plus M3, and similarly the higher half period zones, and this will be equal to M1 plus M3 by 2, similarly plus M7 plus M9 by 2, and so on. So this will be, as we see in the case of the summation, M1 plus M3 plus M7 plus M9. So we will get again a bright point corresponding to this. In this manner, we have, in the case of zone plate, a large number of foci, which can be given by an expression F is equal to R1 square divided by 2P plus 1 lambda, where P is equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, and so on. The second example of the device which we can study on the basis of the this Fresnel type of diffraction is the diffraction by a straight edge. A straight edge is formed when, suppose we put a blade, the edge of the blade, in front of a source. It may be a laser or a point source or a cylindrical source, because normally the sources, they are of rod type, and in the case of a rectangular aperture, the wavefront is cylindrical wavefront. So we take a rectangular aperture, and for this in front of this rectangular aperture, we place edge of the razor parallel to the cylindrical aperture. Now, because the aperture is cylindrical, we are getting a cylindrical wavefront. So we see on the screen that the intensity near the region of the geometrical shadow and just above it is not uniform, but is non-uniformly distributed, and this is due to the phenomena of diffraction. Now in the figure, we have shown the intensity pattern at the geometry the intensity is almost the intensity is 1/4 9 by 4 times 4 by 9 times the intensity at the maximum. The intensity increases, becomes maximum, and then again becomes minimum after some if we travel to some distance from the point O to the point Q. Let A be the distance between the source and the razor blade, that is the obstacle, and B is the distance between the source, the obstacle, and the screen, and there is a point O which is at the geometrical end of the edge. Then we have at this point edge, the intensity is not maximum but just half of almost about half of the maximum. We will explain it just after some time. So there is a non-uniform distribution, and we can see the distribution like this. And as we go away from the edge of the edge, the intensity becomes uniform. We can explain it on the basis of the theory intensity variation inside the geometrical shadow. First we come to the which is the point inside the geometrical shadow which decreases regularly as we go more and more inside the geometrical shadow region. In the screen, the point A acts as a pole of the wavefront, means the point A, which is the edge of the razor, this we consider the pole of the wavefront, that is it corresponds to the point O. Now we see at the point O half of the wavefront which is in the region of the geometrical shadow, this is completely blocked, but half of the region which is totally transparent. So at the point O will be the contribution of the entire half of the upper part of the wavefront which is in the transparent region, and this will correspond to the resultant R1 by 2 or M1 by 2, where M1 is the resultant of the entire wavefront. So because half is blocked and half is transparent, so we get the amplitude correspond to the at the point O due to the entire upper half of the wavefront equal to R1 by 2. Now in the region of the geometrical shadow, means as we are going, we see that as we go inside, first the first half period zone will be blocked, and the intensity, the amplitude will be, first is blocked, so Rn1 is blocked, it will be R2 minus R3 plus R4 and so on, that means R2 by 2. As we go further and further, it will be R3 by 2, R4 by 2 and so on, Rn by 2. As we know that R1 is greater than R2, is greater than R3 and so on, therefore the amplitude will decrease gradually as we go more and more towards the region of the geometrical shadow. So the intensity will decrease slowly as we see from the graph on the right hand side, the intensity decreases continuously. At the point O, as I told that this is due to the entire half wavefront which is equal to R1 by 2, and therefore the intensity will be R1 square by 4. Now as we go to the transparent side, there is a point such that it allows one half period zone, complete half period zone. That means that at this point there is one complete half period zone plus the entire upper wavefront. The contribution to the upper entire upper wavefront, as I told, this is equal to R1 by 2, and because of the one half period zone which is totally transparent, this is equal to R1, the amplitude will be equal to R1 plus R1 by 2, or that will be, this will be equal to 3R1 by 2. So the intensity at that point will be equal to 9R1 square by 4. So the intensity will be as shown will be maximum. Then if there are two half period zones which are transparent, the amplitude will become R1 minus R2 due to the two half period zones, and R1 by 2 because of the entire upper half period zone, and therefore this will be equal to R1 minus R2 plus R1 by 2. So again this will correspond to nearly as R1 will cancel, R2 will cancel R1, so this will be nearly R1 by 2, and this will be the intensity equal will be equal to the intensity at the edge, as we can see again from the diagram. As we go above, then it will be R1 minus R2 plus R3 maxima, then R1 minus R2 plus R3 minus R4 the minima again, and so on. As we go further and further, it will be the amplitude due to the entire half period zone above that, and the sum of R1 minus R2 plus R3 up to Rn. And so therefore, as we go farther and farther from the region of the geometrical shadow, we will get a uniform illumination of the screen. So this is how we can explain the diffraction due to a straight edge with the help of the Fresnel's theory. Now, from the picture, from the figure which we have seen, we can find out what will be the positions of maxima and minima with respect to the point O. And for that, we use some mathematics. As I said, small a is the distance between the source and the point A of the razor blade or the geometrical shadow. The distance AO is equal to small b, and as we see that the radius of the wavefront will be equal to A, we can go to any point Q which is situated at a distance x from from the point O, and we can use some mathematics. AQ is equal to under root AQ square plus OQ square. You can draw the figure and you can just verify it. This will be equal to the square root of b square plus y square, and this is equal to b square plus y square divided by 2b square. This is an approximate distance where we may make an expansion of the square root term, that is 1 plus y square by b square to the power half. Now, PQ will be equal to SQ minus SP, and this is equal to this minus A, and we can see this will be equal to A plus B, 1 plus y square divided by A plus B to the power half minus A, and we solve it, this will be equal to A plus B plus y square upon 2A plus B minus A, or this will be equal to B plus y square upon 2A plus B. So the path difference is given by AQ minus PQ, which is equal to the path difference, that is equal to as we have already seen, this will be equal to A y square divided by 2B A plus B. For maximum intensity now, when the intensity will be maximum? 2n plus 1 lambda by 2. Because if there are a single half period zone, or 3 half period zones, or 5 half period zones, in that case the intensity will be maximum. If we have 2 half period zones or 4 half period zones, they will cancel each other. So for maximum intensity, we have A y square divided by 2B A plus B. This is equal to 2n plus 1 lambda by 2. Or y is equal is given by B A plus B 2n plus 1 lambda divided by A. And for minimum, this must be equal to n lambda. Because when the path difference is equal to lambda, it will accommodate 2 half period zones. And the 2 half period zones, the resultant due to the 2 half period zones will be such that a R1 minus R2, so it will cancel, so we will get minima corresponding to this. So A y square divided by 2B A plus B is equal to 2n lambda by 2, or y is equal to square root of B A plus B into 2n lambda by A. So we see that we will get on the screen the different points which are either illuminated bright or they are dark, and the position can be calculated with the help of the formula as we have derived. So this is the case of Fresnel diffraction due to straight edge. Now we see, suppose we put a narrow wire in front of a cylindrical wave front. Now AB is the diameter of a narrow wire which is placed parallel to the cylindrical wave front. This is the type of the Fresnel class of diffraction. So all the source, the obstacle and the screen are at finite distance. Now we can just discuss what will happen. We see two edges in this case. The first edge is at point B and the second is at point A, or vice versa, the first is at point A and second is at point B. Now the point B is in the region of the geometrical shadow, but after B again there is AB is the geometrical shadow, but after B again there is light, and after A towards X or towards Y the region is illuminated, and therefore we see light from both sides. We discuss suppose a particular case with respect to the point A. Now A will act as a straight edge. So the same thing as happens in the case of the straight edge will be repeated here. The point A, the intensity will be given by R1 square by 4, and as we go away from the point A towards X, the intensity will become maximum to 9 R1 square by 4, and then again it will become minimum, almost equal to R1 square by 4, and then again it will be maximum. So it is the case of two straight edges, one on the upper side and the other on the lower side, that is from B. So outside the region of the geometrical shadow, we get the case analogous to the straight edge. But what happens in the region of the geometrical shadow? In the region of the geometrical shadow, now suppose the shadow, a point is such that it allows, it blocks the first half period zone. So the first half period zone is blocked, and there will be contribution due to the entire upper half period zone. Because first is blocked, so the resultant intensity will be R2 minus R3 plus R4 and so on both sides towards B or A in the region of the geometrical shadow. So as we go inside, there will be, the intensity will decrease. But the case is somewhat different. If the wire is sufficiently narrow, in that case there is a possibility that the contribution due to the lower half period zone also comes into picture. Not only the first half period zone, the upper region, but the lower region can also contribute. So there will be two regions, light coming from the upper half period zone and lower half period zone. And because of that, the contribution will be from both the half period zones. Now suppose the light reaching from the lower half period zone and the upper half period zone differ in phase. If it differs in phase by pi by pi, That is, if the power difference is lambda by 2 or 3 lambda by 2 or 5 lambda by 2, then in that case there will be there will be constructive interference between the lights coming from the two regions of the half-period zone, and we will get destructive interference, and therefore it will be dark. But if it the power difference is suppose integral multiple of lambda, that means lambda, 2 lambda, 3 lambda and so on, then in that case the interference between the light coming from the two different regions will be will show constructive interference, and so there that points will be maximum. So what will happen? We will get alternate points of minimum and maximum intensity and inside the region of the geometrical shadow. So this we have shown in here, the distribution. As I discussed, the wavefronts, the part of the regions which are exposed, that is which are outside the region of the geometrical shadow of thin wire, they will act like two straight edges, the first on both sides, and therefore we will have the maximum and minimum intensity distribution analogous to that of the straight edge. But what happens in the region inside the geometrical shadow? I told you that the intensity will decrease continuously, but because of the contribution of the two sides, there will be interference between the lights reaching from the two different sides, and therefore this will show a maximum and minimum. As we can see, the points at which the power difference for the light coming from the two different regions is lambda by 2 or n lambda by 2, multiple of n lambda by 2, they will be dark, and where the power difference is equal to n lambda or 2n lambda, they will be bright. So we will get alternate dark and bright bands corresponding to each. Now suppose we take a thick wire. We have seen that in the case of the thick wire, now the thickness is considerable. Suppose this is a wire of diameter which is about a millimeter or more than that. In the case of the thin wire, the diameter of the wire should be about 10 to the power minus 2 millimeters or less. Only in that case we can see this type of distribution. If the wire has a thickness more than, say, this is of the order of millimeters or more, then in that case we will call it a thick wire. Then in the case of thick wire, thin wire here is wrongly written. This is the case of the thick wire as it is written in the bottom of the figure. So in the case of thick wire, now this will act as two distinct straight edges, and because the contribution of the other side will be much less, because only very few half period zones will be allowed, and these half period zones which have a very higher order. So suppose 100 half period zones of one side are blocked, then in that case this will act as the contribution will be corresponding to the only one part which is nearer to the transparent part in both the directions. So only contribution from that part will be important, and therefore the intensity will drop gradually. So and at one point this will become minimum, and then on the other side, if you go to the other side, then on the other side also the intensity will increase gradually, because the other side is also transparent after a certain distance. And therefore, we will get to the contribution, will make a diffraction pattern due to two straight edges, and then two straight edges mixed into one. And we can see it in this case analogous to thick wire. Now there are different other examples which we can discuss on the basis of Fresnel class of diffraction, where the source as well as the screen, they are at finite distances with respect to the aperture. If we take suppose a circular aperture or a circular disk, it will be the same, that the diffraction pattern will be different. And if we understand the two cases, that the diffraction due to the straight edge and thick wire, now we understand in which regions we can have the maximum intensity and minimum intensity. So all these cases now, they can of Fresnel's type of diffraction can be explained satisfactorily. So with this, I thank you all for a constant listening to the lecture. And in the next lectures, now we will discuss the Fraunhofer class of diffraction. Thank you very much.